My lords, before I come to the order of my submissions, I'd like to make three preliminary points, which I hope will assist in understanding what follows. Can I start with the procedural chronology at page 2? In fact, it's probably better to start at page 1, the last entry. And what you'll see there is set out the order that was made in AM, which is what was appealed to the Court of Appeal. And you'll see there, first of all, a quashing order. Secondly, a declaration. And that was a declaration that the refusal, continuing refusal to admit, is unlawful, being in breach of Dublin III and or the procedural dimension of Article 8 and or common law requirements of procedural fairness. Do you then see that that was not the mechanism by which entry was achieved? It was number three, an order that the Secretary of State forthwith make all necessary and immediate arrangements for the transfer of the child applicant from France to the UK using best endeavours and not later than. And then at 4, there was an order for a fresh lawful decision. And we'll have a look later at what the basis for that was in the judgment. But I just want to emphasise that, of course, 3 was not present in the judgment or the order in this case. The second preliminary point is to highlight an important legal and factual detail about the expedited process, and that is that as FTH, the respondent, the Secretary of State and all other relevant parties had understood contemporaneously at the time of the expedited process, it was viewed as a Dublin III process. That is what it was understood to be at the time. And the question of whether it was or wasn't a Dublin III process, and whether an asylum application had or had not been made within the meaning of Dublin III in that process, was not settled until the Court of Appeal's judgment on the 31st of July 2018. In other words, after FTH had arrived in the UK. Until that point, the position chronologically was as follows. Until the 8th of February 2017, it was viewed by everyone concerned, including the Secretary of State, as a Dublin III process. The Secretary of State then changed her mind and had made an announcement in Parliament saying it wasn't. But obviously that was not a communication that would have been available to the respondent. There was then a judgment of the upper tribunal saying that it was a Dublin III process in April 2017. That's the AM and others judgment. So from that point onwards, it was viewed as a matter of UK law as a Dublin III process. That's what the courts had said. There was then Citizens UK in the High Court, which reached a contrary view that it wasn't a Dublin III process. So there were then two conflicting judgments in this jurisdiction as to whether it was or wasn't a Dublin III process. And the matter, as I say, wasn't settled until 31st of July. Now, why is this relevant? It's relevant because if this had been a Dublin III process, there is no question that a claim of this type, relying on Article 8 and complaining about the interference with FTH's Article 8 rights as a result of the procedural unfairness of the process, could have been brought in this, brought and could have succeeded in this jurisdiction. As my lords will be aware, in MS, in the case of MS, but also in many other tribunal judgments, the argument that ZT Syria precludes reliance on Article 8 in the context when a Dublin III decision has been taken has been consistently rejected. And that is in MS.
Sorry, argument that is anti-Syria.
Precludes reliance on Article 8 in challenging decisions taken under Dublin III. Has been consistently rejected, most recently in MS, tab 11, paragraphs 61 and 65. Yes. It's tab 11. My Lord's Master Rolls and Lord Justice Hickinbottom will remember this judgment from last year. But the main issue in that judgment was whether the appeal. There were a couple of issues, but whether the appeal should be dismissed as academic, whether Article 27 of Dublin III applied to refusals of take charge requests as well as decisions to transfer, and that is the subject of my Lord Justice Hickinbottom's judgment. But my Lord the Master of the Rolls, at paragraphs 59 onwards, addresses the issue of whether ZT Syria has any relevance to the to any of the questions before that court below, Article 8 having been relied upon. And your lordships will see at paragraph 61, in the detailed grounds of defence, reference was made to ZT Syria. Passages from the judgments in those cases were quoted to the effect that processes in the Dublin system should be circumvented by recourse to Article 8 of the ECHR in very exceptional circumstances, only be circumvented in very exceptional circumstances. And then there were other allegations, other arguments made about the allegations under Article 8. And then at paragraph 64, the court goes on. Lord Justice Hickinbottom has set out in paragraph 5 above the two grounds of appeal in her arguments for dismissing the appeal on the footing that its academic, as Kilroy relied upon, among other things, the right to challenge refusals by the Secretary of State of take charge requests as infringements of Article 8 of the ECHR, irrespective of rights and obligations under Dublin III, applying ordinary domestic law judicial review principles, and also bearing in mind the Secretary of State's acceptance on the appeal that there is a residual power in judicial review proceedings to make findings of fact. And two, when called upon to determine whether there is a breach of Article 8, the court has to decide proportionality for itself and may be required to resolve issues of disputed fact. ZT Syria and RSM, cited in the grounds of defence and in the arguments before us on the appeal, are not relevant to that line of argument and are plainly distinguishable on their facts as cases in which the applicants were seeking to bypass or override express procedures under the Dublin process which would otherwise have applied. So Article 8 in the an Article 8 challenge in the context of Dublin III is not covered by ZT Syria. And I highlight that simply because the court came to a conclusion on the law. Is it pure issue of law? You can see that.
Well, the trouble is this point, as I said in 66,
yes,
wasn't really argued. That's the trouble.
Well, it was argued.
She didn't. It was a very odd situation because it did feature below, but she said she didn't want us to decide the point. It was slightly odd.
Well, that was a different argument that she made at 66 about whether you could have judicial review at all. That wasn't the ZT Syria argument. The point that she didn't argue at 66 was whether you should have whether judicial review was available at all, because your lordships may recall that one of the issues that arose at the start of that hearing was that the Secretary of State suggested that the only way in which you could challenge a decision if you to refuse a take charge request was if you met the ZT Syria test. And it then became apparent in the course of submissions, in the course of my submissions, that of course that wasn't correct, because there was a whole avenue by which you could challenge those decisions, which was judicial review. And at a certain point in Ms. Giovanetti's submissions, she suggested that perhaps there was an issue about whether judicial review was available, but she didn't. She asked the court not to address that. So that's what 66 is about. But the ZT Syria point was argued. It was a basis of Ms. Giovanetti's submissions on behalf of the Secretary of State. And the court, as the tribunal has consistently done, rejected the suggestion that you could not rely on Article 8 in the context of the Dublin III system. That suggestion had come from a passage that my learned friend took you to this morning in RSM, where Lord Justice Singh said Article 8 has, I think the language he used, I don't want to misquote it, but has no application.
Yes, it's not applicable. But paragraph 64 concerns whether a challenge applying ordinary domestic law judicial review principles is available.
Yes.
ZT Syria doesn't help with that. Well, that's right.
Well, ordinary judicial review principles, including Article 8.
Well, I don't understand that. What does that mean? Ordinary judicial review principles, we know what they are, the conventional judicial review principles. As to unlawfulness, Article 8 is a different kettle of fish.
Well, it's the method by which one judicial review in following the Human Rights Act, and perhaps it's worth having a quick look at the Human Rights Act, it's in tab 1.
Well, we can certainly look at it. I suspect we all know what
yes, well, I
the
understand.
Human Rights Act says. But
it says that judicial review is the mechanism for challenging.
Of course.
Use it for raising Article 8 claims.
We know that, but that's a different thing. What that says is that as a procedural matter, you make a claim for judicial review to challenge Article 8. That's a mechanical matter. That's not what's said here. This concerns judicial review principles, that is, principles of unlawfulness. We know what they are, but they don't include Article 8. Article 8 stands outside those, because Article 8 doesn't go to lawfulness in that sense.
Well, what the passage goes on to say, applying ordinary domestic law judicial review principles, and also bearing in mind the Secretary of State's acceptance on the appeal that there is a residual power in judicial review proceedings to make findings of fact, and when called upon to determine whether there is a breach of Article 8, the court has to decide proportionality for itself, and it may be required to resolve issues of disputed fact. So that's in the context of judicial review. So ZT Syria had no application and did not preclude those kinds of challenges and did not impose a threshold test. That was the point. The suggestion was that there was a threshold test to reliance on Article 8 when challenging decisions taken under Dublin III.
And you say...
And that was rejected in MS. And now the point I'm making about the expedited process is that a pure issue of law arose about whether the expedited process was or wasn't a Dublin III process. In the end, it was found not to be a Dublin III process. But that simple fact, in my respectful submission, cannot have such a catastrophic consequence in terms of the test that is applied to whether a decision, a domestic decision, is a breach of Article 8 or not. So that's a simple preliminary point. But
the preliminary point, can I just make sure I've got the preliminary point? You say that Article 8 in the context of Dublin III is not covered by ZT Syria. That's the note I've got.
Yes, so when a challenge is brought to a decision that is taken by the Secretary of State following an application for asylum under Dublin III and a take charge request, so the situation in RSM was that there was a take charge request that was made. Sorry, an MS, a take charge request that was made and and refused, and a challenge was then brought to the refusal of that take charge request. And the argument was made that Article 8 was engaged by that refusal and had been breached because an unlawful decision had been taken as to whether the children, the child was related to his adult sibling in the UK. And ZT Syria did not impose a threshold test in that question, because quite apart from anything else, Article 7 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights governs the application of Dublin III. And so all decisions under Dublin III have to comply with Article 8 and Article 7 of the Charter. So there is no threshold test to decisions taken within Dublin III. And the simple point that I'm highlighting here, and it may not be as turn out to be as simple as I'd hoped, but the simple point that I'm highlighting is that there was a real controversy of law with different courts reaching different conclusions on whether the expedited process was a Dublin III process. And it wasn't resolved until this court's judgment in Citizens UK on 31st of July 2018. But that only highlights that the nature of the decision that was taken, apart from whether as an issue of law it fell within or outside Dublin III, was the same. It was a domestic, it really goes back to the point I made in opening, it's a domestic decision taken by the Secretary of State, either in the exercise of Dublin III, if it had been, but in the end it wasn't, or as an exercise of her policy and that bilateral arrangement that she had reached with France, creating this expedited process. And the decisions taken in that process do not fall within the principle set out in ZT Syria, just as they don't when the decisions are taken under Dublin III. So that's the second preliminary point. The third preliminary point I wanted to make was a point it's in our skeleton argument, and it's in the judgment of the tribunal, but it's really important because the applicant, the respondent rather, FTH, the applicant below, had turned 18 by August 2017, and that had profound consequences for what he could or couldn't do under Dublin III. Dublin III, and I think it is worth me just taking you briefly to it, it's at tab 22. Dublin III has a hierarchy of criteria. If you turn to page, it's at the top, it goes 1L180.39. Begins chapter 3.
Yes.
And there is a hierarchy of criteria that are applied in determining who the member state is that is responsible.
Yes.
At the top of that hierarchy is Article 8. And the first limb of Article 8 is 8.1. And 8.1 is what applied to FTH because he was seeking to join his sibling. And it provides that for mandatory responsibility for the United Kingdom, in the event that the child has a sibling who is lawfully is legally present in the UK, provided it's in his best interest. So that's a mandatory criteria. Once the child turns 18. And before we turn over the page, I'd like to highlight Article 7.2. The member state responsible, in accordance with the criteria set out in this chapter, shall be determined on the basis of the situation obtaining when the applicant first lodged his or her application for international protection with a member state.
So where are you reading from now?
This is 7.2, just above Article 8. I should just say that Article 8.1 was one of the criteria in the expedited process. The expedited process lifted the criteria from Article 8 and used it in the expedited process. That was one of the reasons why there was a controversy about whether it was Dublin III or it wasn't Dublin III, and whether it was lawful or it wasn't. But Article 7.2, if an application for asylum is made, it fixes the time so that all subsequent decisions as to whether you are, as to where, who is responsible for your asylum claim, are made based on the date of that application. But because on the 31st of July 2018, the court decided that the expedited process was not a Dublin III process, contrary to the original belief of the Secretary of State and everyone involved, that meant that if the FTH had applied for asylum after he turned 18, he would have been treated as an adult, and he would not have been benefited from the mandatory criteria of Article 8.1. Instead, he would have had to rely on Article 17.2. And Article 17 is a discretionary clause, and it's over the page at 180/41.
Applied when once he reached adulthood, he couldn't rely upon the special criteria, if I can put it like that, for a minor as to what was in the best interest. Got that, then he went on to something else.
So Article 7, he would, as an adult, seeking to join a family member in the UK, France would have been required to rely on Article 17.2. Which is in fact the article they did rely on in the end, albeit that was part of a settlement process. So, and that is a discretionary clause, and under the Secretary of State's policy, it is to be exercised only in rare and exceptional cases. That is, and I can hand up a copy of the policy, but in a sense, we will have a look at the tribunal's judgment, because that is why, when the Secretary of State argued below that there was an alternate remedy for the, and it was run not as a ZT-Syria point, but as a simple, it was run at a permission stage as a basis as to why permission should be refused. There was an alternative remedy. The applicant could apply could apply to the UK via Dublin III, and therefore permission should be refused. And the tribunal rejected that on a number of bases, but one of the bases was that by the time that was done, he was not an alternative remedy, because he would have had a mandatory entitlement to come to the UK under Article 8 prior to turning 18. And afterwards, he only had a discretionary basis for coming to the UK. And so that was an important feature of this case. And the other important feature, which I will draw out when we look at Citizens UK, is that until he turned 18, the position in France, as a result of the expedited process and following the conclusions of this court in Citizens UK, was that any decision that was taken on a Dublin III application until Mr. Justice Sewell's judgment in Citizens UK in September 2017, the Secretary of State had made clear that she would use the procedurally unfair interview records as part of her consideration as to whether to accept a take charge request or not. So in other words, this is the point about the expedited process infecting what followed. And that was the conclusion that this court came to in Citizens UK, paragraphs 96 to 98, was that it infected, the procedural unfairness of that process infected both the filter process that followed and applications that might be made under Dublin III. So for FTH, there was never any real access to a fair Dublin III process after, which would have given him what he had been entitled to In other words, mandatory responsibility under Article 8. There was never any access, Article 8, Dublin 3, I should say. There was never any access to that before he turned 18 and then lost that entitlement as a result of the procedural unfairness and the expedited process. So that's an important aspect of why the tribunal came to the conclusions it did on alternate remedy, and we'll see some of those conclusions now. So turning to the judgment, it's summarised in our skeleton argument at paragraphs 45 to 53, which is in the core bundle at 62 to 66.
I'm not sure where these trouble is. I guess not sure how we fit into the analysis. I mean, you spent a lot of time on these preliminary points. If you take your last one, which you spent quite a lot of time on, which ended up with the proposition until he turned 18, he didn't. FTH didn't have. He didn't have the what you described as the access to Article 8.
Well, my lord, it fits
legal
into the
analysis. The legal analysis, yes. As opposed to kind of, you know, the merits point, but I mean the legal analysis. How did it fit in there?
Well, when we look at ZT Syria, we'll see how the ZT Syria test works at all. But one of the arguments, the persistent argument that my learned friend has made throughout his submissions, is that FTH could and should have applied for asylum, and indeed should have been advised, even after he turned 18, to apply for asylum in France in order to avail himself of the Dublin III processes. But it is obviously highly relevant to that submission that actually, if he had applied for asylum, the implication being that then he could have come to the UK via that process. But the evidence, which was accepted by this court in Citizens UK, and also in this judge in the court by the court below, was that if he had applied for asylum, these are findings of fact. If he had applied for asylum, it is likely that it would have been refused because of the procedurally unfair findings and interviews that had been conducted in the expedited process. That is what would have happened.
The transfer request would have been refused.
Yes, the take charge request would have been refused. And indeed, in the AM and other cases, that is precisely what happened. Because until Mr. Justice Sewell's
I understand
order,
what you're saying.
Yes.
Maybe I've lost the plot on the structure, but my understanding of the structure of the argument that was being advanced in the Secretary of State, partly prompted in an exchange with my lord, was that when you come to consider Article 8 and you look at one engagement and two infringement, assuming that Article 8 is engaged, you look at the question of infringement by taking the whole setting. And the whole setting has two features to it. One is there is already a process set up for applications under Dublin III, and Dublin III itself is a reconciliation of, as I could say, substantive Article 8 and procedure. That's why it trumps Article 8, except in exceptional circumstances. So that was one of the points that was made in that context. And the second one was that point that France has its own obligations under Article 8. That was the structure of the analysis as to why, even if Article 8 is engaged, which I think in the end is accepted it was, there was no infringement. What I'm trying to work out in my mind as you're making all these points is, well, how does that meet? I mean, I don't want to say we're both sides talking across each other. I'm trying
yes.
to see how that fits into that analysis. Or do you say that isn't the right analysis?
I say structure. That the proper analysis is the usual Article 8 analysis, which is engagement, in accordance with the law, and proportionality. That's the usual.
Engagement and infringement.
Engagement, infringement, and then justification. Yes.
Related to infringement, what's being said is, well, there are two issues to consider, leaving aside justification for any of the grounds under 8.2.
Yes.
There's a whole issue about what it is that's being allegedly infringed. And here in this context, it's your right, I think what's being said is, your right to apply for a transfer to be with somebody, a member of your family. This is the context of this. And it said, well, you could always do that under Dublin III. Now, you seem to be making a point here, and I need to sort of fit it in mentally into the analysis. You seem to be saying, yes, but that, I think what you're saying is, that is not an answer on the facts of this case, because any application that was made under Article 8, any application would have been made, would have been subject to this flawed interview process and examination of the application, and then say it would be likely to have been, it was refused, and it was refused for those reasons, and if it had been made after that process, it would have resulted in a weakened application that would probably be refused, because Article 17 is discretionary, and that discretion would be infected by the policy of the Secretary of State. I think that's where it fits into the analysis. Is that right?
Well, there is and apologies for the lack of clarity, and it may be that the preliminary point approach wasn't a good one. But the starting point in our case is that there was a decision under the expedited process which was unlawful because it did not comply with common law, but also procedural requirements under Article 8. And as a result, it reached obviously the wrong conclusion, because the evidence is clear on that, if the procedural requirements of Article 8 had been complied with, they would have reached a positive conclusion on the family relationship, as they ultimately did when they properly looked at their records. So that's the starting point. It's the Secretary of State's case that, despite that obvious unlawfulness in that early decision, the FTH is not permitted to seek a remedy under Article 8 in UK courts. He must instead first go and try to persuade France to make a take charge request and the UK to accept the take charge request. And that is what ZT Syria requires when seeking to challenge a UK decision under the expedited process. So the respondent's argument is that that is the wrong approach as a matter of principle. ZT Syria does not apply because the applicant is entitled to seek his remedy in a UK court for an unlawful UK decision without first going and asking France to make a take charge request. That's the primary argument. The preliminary point really goes to illustrate how that argument doesn't work in any event on the facts, because what this court found in Citizens UK is that the expedited process infected the Dublin III process, which may have followed, any Dublin III process which may have followed, right up until Mr. Justice Sewell made his order in September 2017. So that's where the point fits in.
Right. Now I understand.
So the judgment is at in the core bundle, tab 8. As I say, it's summarised in the skeleton paragraph.
Can you just give me a page?
Yes, it's 78. And starts off obviously with setting out the facts. And and the background to his application and what happened in the expedited process. And I won't take your lordships through that, but it does describe and summarise some of the unfairness that occurred in that process and how that the process was set up. And you can then see at paragraph 17 to 19 a discussion of the suggestion that had been made that there was an alternative remedy as a result of a consent order that had come in the proceedings. And at paragraph 19, the tribunal concluded the potential opportunity to enter the UK under the provisions of Article 17.2 did not amount to an alternative remedy to the current application, coming as it did too late for proper instructions to be taken. So that is a rejection of that argument. It's not under appeal, that particular conclusion. The alternative remedy argument, I'm not going to take you to it, but it had already been rejected at permission stage. And that is in pages, it's at tab 13 of the bundle, which is page 194 and following. And alternative remedy is dealt with at paragraphs 29 to 46. To 32. It's at 194. And the conclusion of the tribunal accepts the arguments that I've just put to you as to why there was no, the availability of Dublin III in France was not an alternative remedy. So it's page
that's
2.
That's in relation to the period when he was still a minor. Is that right?
No, it's in relation to the whole period, because the suggestion was being made then that once, that instead of bringing the judicial review,
he could have applied
under Dublin III.
Applied under Article 8 of Dublin III until he was...
Well, no, the Secretary of State did not suggest that he could apply under Article 8 of Dublin III. The Secretary of State accepted that was impossible, that was not possible. In fact, it was that was her argument that it wasn't possible. The applicant actually said it was, because it was the applicant's position that the expedited process had been a Dublin III process. But the respondent's position was that an application should be made under Article 17.2. I recognise it says Regulation 8 there of Dublin III. I don't think that was the
result.
Paragraph 29, which is at page 200 under the heading Alternative Remedy. So it was the argument that was an alternative remedy to the judicial review was rejected. And as I say, that alternative remedy conclusion is not under appeal, nor are those findings. And in my respectful submission, some of my learned friends' submissions crossed over into an argument that there was an alternative remedy. But there wasn't, for the reasons that the tribunal found. Turning back to the main judgment at 78, the tribunal described the expedited process itself.
When you say it wasn't available, as a matter of law, an alternative process was available. But none of the parties involved thought it was.
As a matter of law, it was available, and that is a finding in Citizens UK, and I'm not seeking to go behind that. It was, as a matter of law, a formal application could have been made, and that's what the court found in Citizens UK. I think it's paragraph 50. But at a later stage in Citizens UK, the court also accepted that although it was available, it is likely that the expedited process infected what then happened. That's at paragraphs 96 to 98. So it would not have been a fair process because the expedited process was infecting it. So it was formally available, but it wasn't practically going to achieve what it should have done. And that is that's the conclusion of this court in Citizens UK. So, my lord, turning back to the main judgment, there is a description of the expedited process at paragraphs 21 onwards, page 87. With reference to the disclosure that was made very late as a result of this case. My Lord, Lord Justice Hickinbottom will recall that one of the central bases on which the process was found to be unlawful was the lack of reasons, and it was revealed in the course of this case, or indeed as a result of this case, but after the conclusion of this hearing, that reasons had been withheld by the Secretary of State on legal advice in order to avoid legal challenge. And that was one of the aspects of the process that was commented on in Citizens UK. So there is commentary about that in the judgment. And then at paragraph 41, my learned friend has already taken you to this, I believe. The tribunal said it wasn't going to consider the Dublin III aspect of the case unless no breaches appeared to have occurred at common law under Article 8. So that was the basis for not considering Dublin III, because it was about to be considered by the Court of Appeal in CUK, and Citizens UK and AM and others. At 42 onwards, and I won't take your worships through it, is consideration of common law fairness, which mirrors much of what was later decided in the Court of Appeal. And you'll see at paragraph 64 the conclusion that the applicant, the respondent, FTH, did fully cooperate with the expedited process at a time when he believed it was a Dublin III process. And at 67, the reference to the appellant in this case's officials regarding the expedited process as a Dublin III process at 67. And then at 68 to 69 are the prejudice findings. So if he had made such a formal application with a view to being transferred under Dublin III, the adverse findings made against him in the expedited process were likely to have prejudiced such an application. And there's reference to what Mr. Justice Sewell found, and then at paragraph 69 again, even if the applicant had made an application for asylum with a view to being transferred to the UK under Article 8 before he became 18 on the 11th of August, it is likely that the adverse findings made against him under the expedited process would have led to a refusal under this article. And so they then say that's not a factor they're going to hold against him. But that's an important finding of fact on the evidence that was before the tribunal. And it's not under appeal, nor could it be, because the evidence is absolutely clear on this issue. So really, the suggested course that my learned friends says on behalf of the Secretary of State that the respondent should have taken would have produced a nil result. for him and no remedy. And that is very different from what the court was considering in ZT Syria.
So I'm just trying to work out the chronology of this. He turns 18 in August 2017. And at that point, and he previously in December 2016, he'd been told that the family union application was rejected.
Yes.
Right, so between December 2016 and August 2017, he's still a minor.
Yes.
And at that point, I'm just trying to get it, I'm not making a point against you or for you, I'm just trying to get it straight in my own mind. At that point, the provisions of Article 8 of Dublin III apply.
Yes.
And the French are under an obligation, as are the British authorities, to follow Dublin III Article 8 at that point.
Yes.
And I take all your points about what happens after August. I take your point about after achieved 18. I'm just trying to understand this period of time. So, apart from everybody's... But now, when was the belief... When did Mr. Justice Sewell give his judgment?
September 2017, and one of the important intervening features of this case, which is all explained both in the factual story that is told in Citizens UK, but also in this judgment under the heading the filtration process, is that after the decision was taken in the expedited process, there was extensive discussion between the French and the UK authorities about reviewing decisions that had been taken in the expedited process. Sometimes this was called an appeal, sometimes it was called a review or a reconsideration. But the French had been pressing, and this is the information that came out as a result of the late disclosure, the French had been pressing the UK authorities to review the decisions that were taken in the expedited process and to provide reasons for them so that the review could be effective. And the review process continued until at least the end of March into April 2017. The applicant was one of the individuals, sorry, I keep saying the applicant, the respondent, FTH, was one of the individuals who was put forward for review. But at the same time, the French were asking the United Kingdom authorities for reasons for the refusal, because without those reasons, they could not provide the additional information that the UK authorities were requesting in order to reach a different or positive decision. So one of the findings in this judgment is that, and this is relevant to some of the observations that were made in the course of my learned friend submissions, the French authorities were trying to engage with the review process until at least April 2017.
Yes. The chronology says that this helpful chronology is supplied by
the
Mr. Kenner.
Yes.
Was that on 6th of January 2017, following ongoing pressure and discussion between the senior French and UK officials, the process for reviewing cases refused in expert cases is agreed. So the review process is agreed, the filtration process in January 2017.
Well, it is agreed, but what was not agreed was the terms of the review process. So there were continuing discussions, and you can see this from the emails that are set out in Citizens UK about the terms of the review process. There was a huge amount of dispute because the French authorities said that they could not persuade the children to engage with the review process in the absence of having proper reasons for the decisions to refuse, because the British had said that it was only if there was additional information that they would give positive decisions. And you can see all of this in Citizens UK, and I think it probably is worth having a quick, at least highlighting it for your Lordship's notes. It's at tab 8 of the authorities bundle. and the emails start under the heading The Duty of Candor and Cooperation, starts at 105, page 13 of the judgment transcript. And then there is reference to the evidence filed in the High Court, 107 onwards. And then you start to see the relevant emails on this issue.
What's the conclusion of the court on this?
The conclusion of the court is that the filtration process, and this is at 96 to 98, was not fair. So 96 to 98,
okay,
pure Dublin III process. At 95, you can see, could not be in practice be insulated from what had gone before.
So I mean, I understand. That's the point you made before.
Yes.
I think, to me. But is there anything more that we need to?
It is simply this, that in that in the emails, what you will see, and it's at 160, there are to 162. You see that what the UK officials were saying to the French is, for example, at the end of the email at 160, we did a good job of interviewing the children. If we agree to this process, we do not want to see all the children we previously identified as ineligible under doubling being referred to us again. Whilst this will be essentially delaying the issue, the French believe this delay will give them a better chance of convincing minors to claim asylum in France. And then at 161, the court concludes, this is a good example of how the outcome of the earlier expedited process to continue to have an impact on what happened later. And then you see at 162, this is an official and Secretary of State, one of the Secretary of State's officials, explaining how the filtering process would work. And I note there, since we're there, if there is a suggestion that we will ask, that the French will ask, tell the minor, this is in the middle of that paragraph, to apply for asylum and go through the normal Dublin process. If they refuse, then that will be the end of it for them. If the application is unlikely to be successful, they will try to persuade the minor to apply for asylum in France. That way we don't have to do a formal rejection. And I just want to highlight at that point this idea of applying for asylum in France. The language that is used is often... what that means is a substantive application for asylum in France, not one with a view to being transferred under Dublin III. And then at 163...
Well, what this reveals, leaving aside the rightness or wrongness of it, or the moral position, is that the British officials didn't want a situation to come about where they found they had to accept these children in circumstances where they'd already rejected them. And they were doing anything that they could to ensure that didn't happen. So when they talked about persuading the minor to apply for asylum in France, they meant that and not engaging in the Dublin III process at all.
That's exactly.
Otherwise, it's a pointless. Why do it? Because if they were going to come here under Dublin III, then.
That's
because
exactly
he's talking about minors, so they would have a right to come under Article 8, Dublin III.
Right.
So the idea was that if the children, and you can see that from, I realise this is taking time, but it is important to understand the...
Well, I'm trying to, I'm a great person for simplifying things.
Yes.
I'm trying to get a simplified structure and working out what the issue is.
Yes.
That's why I keep on coming back to the same point. My understanding is, and I may be wrong, but my understanding is this point all goes to the context in which one's considering whether or not Article 8 has been infringed, not whether it's engaged. That all this goes to the question of, can it be said that Article 8 is infringed? On the one hand, it's put, yes, it has not been infringed because the context is Dublin III, and the context is French responsibility for young people as well as the British, and therefore the Article 8 rights, as it were, of this applicant are catered for already in these other two areas. That's a simple proposition. Took time to get there, but we've got that was the proposition.
Yes.
My understanding is what your point goes to in saying, no, that is not, well, insofar as that's the context, Dublin III was not an available and appropriate procedure which put these children in the same position they would have been in had there been no breach of Article 8 procedural rights. That's what that all goes to. They couldn't be put back into that position simply by saying, well, they were still for the rights even before he was 18. They couldn't be put in the same position as he would have done because, one, there was the process that was going on of considering what they should be doing. They all thought it was under Dublin III, and there was this policy process, and the court has reached the conclusion already that it was likely that that would have prejudiced their application.
Yes,
that's why, as I see in my mind, this is where the battle lines are drawn on this issue.
Yes. Well, I'm very grateful for the simplification, and I apologise for the time taken, but part of this process is highlighting ZT Siri was a very simple situation in essence. It was a situation in which there had been no previous decision-making. Some children, the children applicants in that case had written some letters saying that it's not working in France, the Dublin III process. There is an article. We have an Article 8 right to join our family members. Please admit us. And that was what the legal issue was that was considered there. This is a much more complex situation arising out of the fact there was a whole decision-making process, including the expedited process, the filter process, lack of disclosure, lots of misconduct of the UK authorities, with ongoing consequences.
And you say, following on from the point I was making, that the tribunal has made findings, both in refusing permission and in its judgment, to the effect that using the Article 3 process was not an appropriate alternative remedy available to this respondent.
Yes, I say that precisely. I'm very grateful. Yeah.
And is that why AM is distinguishable?
Well, I'll have to come on to why AM is distinguishable.
So that's the critical
question.
Perhaps I can leave it like this. We had a three-day hearing in front of the upper tribunal in which we went through an enormous amount of evidence, which is all summarised in the judgment, about how the process worked, the prejudice to the applicant from all the various things that happened, whether he could reasonably have been expected to know even that he could apply for asylum and thereby join in France and thereby join his relative or not. Those findings are not under attack in these proceedings. And the problem with my learned friend's submissions with respect is that they ignore that factual backdrop and make assertions about what was or wasn't available in terms of applying for Dublin III and so on, which are just not consistent with this, with the
factual picture. I think the correct, where you correctly could put it, is to say that the arguments that were put forward by Mr. Keller are, in theory, in principle, correct, but they don't accord with the facts of this case.
Exactly. That is precisely, and I apologise that it's taken me so long to make what is essentially a simple point, but I do want to emphasise that's all in the unagreed bundle, and there was more. There is a massive amount of information about what actually happened in a very complex and confusing process. That has been the subject of multiple judgments now from the tribunal and the Court of Appeal and the High Court, and none of that is really touched on by this theoretical argument that my learned friend has made, a theoretical argument based on ZT Siri, which was a completely different set of facts.
But as Malone said, that human rights is never theoretical. You have to look at the facts of the individual case, and I mean, with respect, I think it is. I think the way the Lord's put it, which is a very simple way, is correct. And in this case, there are a lot of sort of red herrings. the alternative remedy. I appreciate it can be called an alternative remedy, but that doesn't seem to me that's helpful. The real analysis, as my Lord has said, is Article 8 engaged, is it infringed? The Secretary of State relies very heavily upon Dublin III. Of course, the Secretary of State says, well, with Dublin III, there's no infringement of Article 8, because an application could be made in Dublin III, Article 8 rights would have been retained. And you say in response, no, because on the facts of this case, because of the findings in Citizens UK and the findings by the Upper Tribunal as to prejudice, Dublin III did not do the trick in this case.
Yes.
And that's it. And that's the issue. I'm not sure what the answer is, but that's the question.
That is what arises out of the judgment. Before I leave the factual part of the judgment, can I just highlight that all of this is summarised in the skeleton argument on what the tribunal found, and the tribunal also found that the evidence on the filter process that had been submitted by the Secretary of State, my learned friend, suggested that it was all very clear. There was a green marker, and if a take charge request had been made, the green marker suggests it would have been accepted. That argument was rejected by the tribunal, having regard to all of the evidence. The tribunal said at paragraphs 100 to 103, core bundle 106 to 107, that the evidence on the filter process was contradictory.
Okay,
core bundle 106 to 107, the evidence on the filter process was contradictory, and that even though the green marking was intended to, was described as giving a green light, it didn't correspond with the number of individuals who ultimately came under the filter process, which was only five, I believe. So, and there was more evidence on the filter process that was submitted after that tribunal hearing. So, some of what my learned friend said about that, again, too simplified, just does not reflect the evidence that was before the tribunal. Now, I want to, before I leave the judgment, just look at the remedy, because we've looked at it already, but my learned friend made a submission about it, 113, of the bundle.
I'm sorry, page?
113 of the core bundle. First of all, can I highlight at 124, the end of that paragraph? This was the conclusion on Article 8 procedural unfairness. So the Article 8 procedural unfairness consideration begins at 114 and ends at 124. And what the conclusion was we find that the manner in which the expedited and filtration process was applied to the applicant gave rise to breaches of natural justice, common law fairness, and also amounted to procedural unfairness for the purposes of Article 8. ECHR, and the applicant has been wrongly deprived of the opportunity to join YH in the UK since 30th of November 2016. So I want to emphasise that, because this was in the end about an unlawful decision. That was what their conclusion was. The decision-making process was unlawful. But the peculiarity of the judgment is, and you can see this at 114, that by the time they produced their judgment, the relationship had been accepted. So that was what was odd about this. The relationship had now been accepted. It had been rejected earlier as a result of a procedurally unfair decision-making process. So there had been that lost opportunity, which had led to a delay in reunification of 1 year and 7 months. And the order, you can see, we've looked at it in an extract from it, the most important extracts, 1 to 3, in the procedural chronology. But my learned friend suggested that there was a further disposal hearing at which a mandatory order might have been made. And you can see that that's just not correct. The only thing that was going to happen after, this was the final order in that case. The only thing that remained outstanding at 4 was written submissions as to costs.
Are you referring now to the Greek chronology?
No, I'm looking at the order and which follows paragraph 124, page
113.
So the order that was made, and I highlighted this earlier on, did not include any order in relation to transfer. It simply included a declaration.
It would have been better. I know I'm nitpicking here now, but it would have been better if and this would have been a normal way of doing it. The declaration should have been first, and then followed by the two caution orders. That would have been easier and clearer, because then you could see that the declaration was not going beyond those orders. Anyway,
yes.
But that would be the normal process with the declaratory relief.
Anyway, yeah, because it's what's declared is the reason for the orders. In other words, they were and are unlawful as being in breach of natural justice. I mean, leave Article 8 out of one side.
Yes.
Breach of natural justice and common law standards of procedural unfairness, from which it follows that the orders must be.
But also, it shows
quashed.
The limitation, because you're saying the answer to Mr. Kellar's point, which is that, you know, the declaration that the refusal to admit is unlawful, as it were, goes beyond just looking at the past.
Yes.
She looks at the future, and you say that's not correct. It's simply looking at the past.
It's a description, it's a past leading to an ongoing. The unlawfulness had consequences up until the date of the judgment, but that's what it's saying.
In
my respectful submission.
You say that the positive orders in this case indicate the limitation of the declaration.
Yes.
But the declaration is that, and I'm still struggling with this, as you say in paragraph 124, what the applicant's been deprived of is the opportunity to join his brother. But the declaration is that the Secretary of State's refusal to admit him to the United Kingdom was and is unlawful as being in breach of, amongst other things, Article 8.
Well, procedural dimensions of Article 8, and that's really important, my lord.
Come on to that. That's a different point. But how do you get the deprivation of an opportunity to join his brother to a declaration that the refusal to admit him to the United Kingdom was unlawful?
Well, for the reason I explained earlier, which is that what the decision was. The decision dated 30th of November and the decision in the filtration process was a refusal to admit. Or certainly, there was always confusion about what the decision in the filtration process was, but the decision of the 30th of November was a refusal to admit. So
quashing a refusal to admit does not equal a decision to admit.
That's your point.
Yes.
I think.
I'm saying that the decision to admit to the refusal to admit was unlawful because it was a breach of common law, natural justice and procedural requirements of Article 8. And that's why it needed to be quashed. And it had ongoing consequences. It had ongoing consequences.
You simply say it doesn't go beyond that. Yeah.
Well, it doesn't. No, it contains it's simply a declaration. It cannot go beyond that. Now, obviously, as with any declaration, the duty lies on a public authority required to comply with the rule of law to correct the unlawfulness. But that doesn't bring it into ZT Syria territory. And I took you earlier to the order in AM just to emphasise how different that was, because in this case they stop at 3, and in AM they went on to make a mandatory order to organise transfer. And that was in a situation where the relationship had not even been accepted. That was, you know, there had been no decision to accept the relationship in AM. So it was outside, that was why it was outside the expedited process. It wasn't even take a new decision within the expedited process and transfer. It was outside the expedited process based solely on Article 8. And that was the vice, as it were, that the Court of Appeal was seeking to correct in AM and others, and we'll come to that in a moment. So that's...
So it wasn't even within... They hadn't accepted the relationship there, and therefore the AM, the order was not even, you said, within...
It wasn't an order to make a new decision under the expedited process. And as I say, you know, the confusion arises over this talk about entry and so on, because the expedited process was about entry. So a refusal of an application in the expedited process was a refusal to transfer or a refusal to admit. But challenging that is an orthodox exercise of judicial review, and I say also Article 8. But what happened in ZT Syria and also in AM was that the admission was made directly on Article 8 without requiring a new decision under the expedited process, which would have been within the expedited. Then the decision would have been within.
In a case in which no decision to admit had been made, unlike this case,
yes.
What the tribunal should have done is to make similar declaration and quashing orders, and then direct that a fresh decision be made under the expedited process.
Yes, and that's, in my respectful submission, that is exactly what the Court of Appeals said should happen in Citizens UK.
So basically, you're going to come to AM, but the important point here is you say that this, all that's been asked for is a quashing of decisions made in the past, and had they not accepted the relationship, which they had in that case, what would have happened is there would have been a fresh consideration.
Yes.
Whereas in AM, you're saying, and in DZ Syria, you're saying in both those cases, the application was for an order for admission outside either Dublin III or the expedited process.
Yes.
That's the point you're making.
Yes. Outside any established domestic or international law decision-making process. Yes.
It would be good if we could finish this today. I'd rather assume we would finish it today.
And, my Lord, that is the reasoning of the tribunal itself in the damages judgment. So before we leave the tribunal's reasoning, the damages judgment explains precisely that. It's at page 194. It is at page 121. Page 121, paragraph 4, and the paragraph is echoed in the damages judgment. So 121. And this is their, my learned friend didn't take you to this passage distinguishing ZT Syria, but this is the heart of the distinction at 3. And if I could just ask you to read it. And that is how that's what they saw themselves as doing.
What was the other passage in the...
Well, there is a passage, that's in the decision on refusing permission to appeal. It isn't. The other passage is in the permission to appeal section, and it's at 118.2c. It's really the same point as to why they refuse permission to appeal based on AM.
Okay.
So that's what the tribunal thought it was doing. So just now turning to the case law on procedural protections under Article 8. I'm going to take the rest of this pretty shortly because it's all dealt with in our skeleton argument in detail. But I adopt everything that's in there and I would be very grateful for your lordships treating it in that way. So it's paragraphs 33 to 34 of the skeleton argument. But what I would like to, the two cases that I'd like to take you to are TP and KM, which is at tab 14. And I will come also to P, C and S. So this was a case about a family law case, effectively, about removing a child from her mother on the grounds that she was at risk of abuse. And paragraph 72 this is the procedural, this is now the common procedural statement as to what Article 8 requires in terms of procedural protections, referring to the cases of W and McMichael, which are also in the bundle, but I won't be taking you to them, but the references are in the skeleton. So at paragraph 72, it's page 82 of the transcript, it's sidelined. The court further recalls that while...
Shall we read this transcript? Yes. How much do you want us to read?
If you could just read that 72 to 73... Those principles are applied in the present case. There is and essentially, the first applicant had not been given enough information, and you'll see that the disclosure was criticised at paragraph 83. If you could have a look at paragraph 83, also sidelined. And you'll see that it's that failure to give her adequate involvement in the decision-making process which constitutes the breach of Article 8 on its own. It's not the consequences of the failure. It's the failure.
And a breach. You run with and a breach of Article 8.
Yes, and a breach of Article 8. So the breach of procedural protections is a breach of Article 8. Now, the court then went on to consider what the remedy should be at Article 13, under Article 13, which of course is incorporated as part of the Human Rights Act mechanism, so Section 6 to 8. So this is at 91 of the transcript, and you'll see paragraphs 107 is sidelined.
I'm sorry, what paragraph?
107. Paragraph 107. Yes. And essentially what was argued by the government in that case was that it was sufficient that the separation that resulted from the unlawful process was brought to an end. It wasn't necessary to provide recompense for the separation that had occurred. And that was rejected, and you can see that at 108. And if I could ask you to read that. So, obviously, I highlight that in this context because what the Secretary of State has said is, well, there may have been a breach of procedural requirements in the expedited process, but you could have brought it to an end with applying for a Dublin under Dublin III. Now, I've queried, and the tribunal did not accept that that was the case on the facts, but in any event, it's not an answer to a breach under Article 8. Thank you.
tonight 108 to basically 110.
Yes. And then you can, there's also 115 side end, which emphasises that what was being compensated for was the loss of opportunity. So they don't even conclude that if the video had been produced earlier, they would have been reunited earlier. You don't have to establish the substantive in order to recover for the procedural. It's a loss of opportunity that is compensated for. And the same point is made in PC&S at tab 15. Another family law case. And then at 1-1, without going into the facts, it's sidelined at 119, page 1107. Again, the same recitation of what the principles are. Referring to McMichael again, W. And then the application in the individual case, as the relevant passage I'd like to draw to your attention at 133, which also sidelined. The draconian step of removing S from her mother was not supported by relevant and sufficient reasons and cannot be regarded as having been necessary in a democratic society, therefore a breach of Article 8. And then you see over the page, in relation to the later adoption proceedings, you'll see that there is a big dispute about what might have happened. And the court says of that dispute at 136, the court does not propose to attempt to untangle these
opposed
principles.
We can read this ourselves. We'll do 136 and
136. 136, please, to 137. I won't take you to them, but there are a number of other cases quoted in the skeleton argument, which apply the same principles in the family reunion context. So that's Tandemizenga, Sengio Longay, Mugenzi, and those are all quoted in the skeleton argument. So that is what Article 8 requires at the decision-making stage. So turning to my third heading, CK and ZT Syria. Again, the skeleton on this issue is very full, and I don't intend to do more than to take you to those paragraphs. But before
haven't you summarised already the way the exchanges with the bench?
Yes.
The point of distinction, which is very shortly, that was a case where the application was made for an order for admission to the United Kingdom outside Dublin III or anything equivalent to the expedited procedure. Well, that's your main point, isn't it?
It is. It is my main point. And but in the course of the judgment, you will see at both at paragraphs 85 and paragraphs 95 that the court contemplates other processes being used. So, for example, at paragraph 85, the court expressly states that where a decision is taken in the context... The particular article they were talking about was Article 17 of Dublin III, a discretionary decision. Where that decision is taken, it must apply ordinary judicial review principles and Article 8. And the point is obviously that any decision that is taken, the court foresees in a domestic or EU law decision-making process. Yes, so it's ZT Syria. Is it tab 5? And, my lord, I just want to highlight in paragraph 6 why the appeal, this was an academic appeal, why was it said to be necessary? it was said that the approach of the upper tribunal, this is in the last section H, this is Mr. Eady, on behalf of the Secretary of State, saying potentially far-reaching and serious consequences for the ability of the UK to control its borders and for the integrity of the Dublin III system. The case was that the UT erred in granting relief to individuals who had refused to claim asylum in France and to make use of the Dublin III mechanism, and also had made no application in the UK for asylum or for leave to enter, and had, for example, provided no biometric data before their arrival. So the whole point was that they hadn't used any of the processes that were set up by the Secretary of State. They hadn't given the Secretary of State what the Secretary of State was would have asked for if they had. But here, the whole issue is turned on its head. They have used a process. FTH did use a process that was set up by the Secretary of State. And it was the Secretary of State who erred in failing to elicit the right information. And as a result, reaching an unlawful decision. Now, how on earth this authority can possibly be used to restrict a challenge based on Article 8 when that is the factual matrix?
You were going to show
us
paragraph 85.
So 85. There had been 85 addresses an absolutist submission that was made by the Secretary of State that there was no need to rely on Article 8 at all because Dublin III itself strikes the proportionate Article 8 balance. That's at 83. And it's rejected at 85 on the basis that it was possible to exercise a power under Article 17 and an individual might ask the Secretary of State to do that. And then in the bottom of that paragraph at F, if I could just ask you to read that last section.
Subject to the effective scope of judicial review being narrow for this reason, the exercise by the Secretary of State for discretion is subject to the ordinary public law principles of propriety of purpose, relevancy of considerations, and the long-stop Wensbury unreasonable category, and, comma, because of the engagement of Article 8 of the European Convention, comma, the intensity of review which is appropriate in the assessment of the proportionality of any interference with Article 8 rights.
Public law principles of propriety and the intensity of review which is appropriate in the assessment. I think that's the way the sentence flows.
You're right. Yes.
Okay. So that's obviously contemplating that in a domestic decision-making process, or one governed by Dublin III, all those considerations will be at play. And essentially, for the reasons set out in the skeleton, which I'm not going to repeat because of the time I've been taking, but it is all set out there, it's a very narrow issue that was considered in ZT Syria. It was not setting down a wide principle. And you can see that from paragraph 95, because it talks about the test is headed by the statement, I consider that applications such as the ones made by these claimants should only be made. So it's only applications such as the ones made by these claimants.
It also makes the point here made by my Lord Justice Hickinbottom, which is referenced always. This is, he says, F, this is subject to the point that these cases are intensely fact-specific.
Yes, and it also makes that point. But I say that even before you get there, it's not an application we are not in an application such as the one made by these claimants. So we don't even get to the acutely fact-sensitive bit of the analysis.
And then we get to the general principle which, on which Mr. Keller relies, which I don't think you take issue with, the general principle that those representing persons in any position of interest should first seek recourse to the authorities. But you say that's subject to the facts of any particular case.
Well, yes, but again, that highlights that the thing that went wrong here is no one can criticise FTH for what he put forward. The criticism is the other way around. I may have misunderstood your lordship's point. You're saying
Keller's made the general point which he gets from this, which is exactly what it says, that generally speaking, those representing persons in the position of the claim should first seek recourse from the authorities in the courts of the member state in which the minor is, only if it is demonstrated, etc., etc.
Yes.
Your point, as I understood it in the way we were discussing, is that may be a general principle, but you have to look at the facts of each case, and that didn't work in this case.
Yes, because the recourse that was necessary in that case was to fix the problem in that case, which was the French problem. It was a French problem that was an issue in that case, which was inability to access the asylum procedures in France. And so for obvious reasons, the court said, well, you've got to be able to show that you can't fix it in France before you come to us. But that's not the issue here. We're addressing...
I'm agreeing with you. That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying to you. You're saying on the facts of this case, that general point doesn't apply.
Yes, I apologise. That's said, T. Siri. Could we just quickly look at CK? Because in my respectful submission, CK actually it puts the point that we're putting and in a passage that my learned friend didn't take you to exactly as we would put it. So it's paragraph 30 of CK. Tab 4.
Tab 4. Yeah.
Paragraph 30. And what the court is there considering is how, and CK is the basis for the test adopted in ZT Syria, but how Article 8 sits alongside Dublin III. And what Lord Justice Laws says is it cannot conceivably have been the intention, if I could ask you to read that passage.
Yeah.
And what I say is it cannot conceivably have been the intention of the court in ZT Syria to prohibit the autonomous application of the Human Rights Act to procedural defects in a UK decision. And if they had tried to do that, it would be repugnant to the Human Rights Act. That is a statute that requires compliance with those obligations and remedies to be available for breach of those obligations. And the Secretary of State's argument seeks to undercut that by suggesting that we have to go, that applicants have to go to France and try to seek remedies there before challenges can be brought in UK courts. That cannot, in my respectful submission, be right. So that's CK and ZT Syria. And I do the paragraphs in the skeleton argument, which also deal with RSM, are at paragraphs 5 to 10.
This is your skeleton?
Yes. 35 to 36. And 37 on RSM. And I adopt those arguments. So at the fourth heading, perhaps the most important one, is the scope of the findings in Citizens UK and AM. And the skeleton deals with this at paragraphs 11 to 16 and 38 to 34. We've spent some time in Citizens UK, so at this stage I'd like to go straight to AM, which is at tab 9. Say is sidelined at paragraph 2. The judgment is said to be shorter because many of the issues have been dealt with in Citizens UK. and the judgment should be read with it, is what the court says. And my learned friend has taken you to paragraph 41. I believe he took you to that, which is where the sets out the remedies that were granted in AM, and I've already made submissions about that. And then at paragraph 53, the Secretary of State's complaint about it. And the Secretary of State's complaint at 53.5 is really important because it's that complaint that was accepted. Article 8 of the ECHR, viewed through the prism of the Court of Appeals decision in ZT Syria, did not require either a different approach to the decision-making or for the children's admission to the UK outside the framework of the expedited process and the Dublin III regulation. And it's those words, outside the framework of the expedited process and the Dublin III regulation, that are important because that was the complaint that was made by the Secretary of State in that case, because that is exactly what had happened. The order was made outside that framework. There was no requirement for a new decision under the expedited process before transfer.
Complaint, I'm going to remember this now, the complaint in AM, was that not similar to the complaint that's made here, which is that there wasn't a proper interview process?
Well, the court...
In the course of the expedited process.
Yes, the tribunal in AM found that the expedited process was flawed because of the procedural requirements of Article 8 as well as common law and Dublin III. But the tribunal in AM, and this it may be that we have to look at AM itself. What it also did was to conclude that because of all those flaws, and because the Secretary of State had not corrected those flaws, having been invited to make new decisions in the course of the proceedings, that on the basis of Article 8 alone, the children should be admitted outside. And that was outside the expedited process and outside Dublin III. So the flaws, the tribunal got to, if we think back to the 1, 2 and 3 of the order that was made in FTH, the tribunal got there, but it then made a further order to admit the children based on Article 8 alone.
Where do we get that bit based on Article 8 alone?
You can see it from
paragraph 41.
You don't get it from the court. It's not clear from the Court of Appeal judgment, except because of the application of ZT Syria. So perhaps before we leave AM, I'd better take you through the rest of it so we don't have to come back again. But I will show you the tribunal judgment on why I'm making that submission. So you then see at 66. The same point is made. Ground 5 relates to Article 8 of the ECHR, and again, didn't require the admission outside the framework of the expedited process and Dublin III regulation. And there's reliance on ZT Syria. The Secretary of State also emphasised that the upper tribunal did not appear to give any recognition to the importance of the fact that children concerned were under the jurisdiction of the French care system. And that's a really important point in the applicants, in FTH's favour, because the whole reason why the order, one of the reasons why the order was considered to be wrongly made, was because it interfered with a current responsibility of the French authorities, and in RSM it had been the Italian authorities, that's where the idea came from in RSM, to exercise their own obligations towards an unaccompanied minor. And that was what Lord Justice Singh was concerned about in RSM, if you look at his judgment in RSM. And it is also what he was concerned about here, and it was the point that was relied on by the Secretary of State, is that by making an order to admit, the court was cutting across the responsibility of the French authorities to assess what was in the best interest of that unaccompanied minor for themselves. So it wasn't about, my learned friend has sought to say, well, FTH was in care at the time of the expedited process. That's irrelevant to this point. This point is about an order to admit by the tribunal at the time of granting relief without permitting the French authorities to discharge their responsibilities, without ensuring, rather, that they had been able to discharge their responsibilities towards the child. That's what that is about. And that, the fact that that point is made emphasises that this was all about admission. The concern that the Court of Appeal had, and the one complained of by the Secretary of State, was all about an order to admit. So that's 66. And then the consideration of this argument is at 87 to 99.
So subject to that point.
Yes.
Subject to that point about the form of the order that the UT have made, all the other points that you've made about why an application couldn't in practice have been made or couldn't be expected to be made in this case under Dublin III did apply in AM. So issues about, well, the policy of the Secretary of State was that if you didn't succeed under the expedited process, that would count against you if you made a formal application under Dublin III. The way that the matter had been processed had been incorrect, and your point about the filibustering by the British authorities, as you submit, in relation to the review, all of those points, all about the only point of distinction, I think, and I'm not saying it's not a vital one, the only point of distinction, I think, is in relation to the order to admit.
Well, my Lord, I don't accept that. And one reason why we produced the procedural chronology, there are two points to highlight at the start. First of all, by the time this appeal came to the Court of Appeal, it was academic. And the it was academic, completely academic. There was no damages claim. AM was academic. And the second point to make is that what was different about those cases is that those children had managed to obtain legal representation contemporaneously with the process, with the filtration process, although in fact we were given very little information about it. So their claims were brought a whole year earlier than FTH's, and they obtained admission at various times over that spring and summer. So they did not ever, they were never exposed to this prejudice. It wasn't considered by the Court of Appeal, is really what I'm saying, because the prejudice that they suffered as a result of, that they might have suffered as a result of, if they had been required to make a Dublin III application, never came to light in these proceedings, because the children were transferred before the, shortly after the filtration process concluded in April 2017.
So when were they actually transferred?
It's in the procedural chronology. You can see that at page 2.
Paragraph 11, is this? No, hang on.
I was actually, there. It's set out in the procedural chronology, although it's probably in AM and others as well.
The Secretary of State accepted AM's asylum claim on the 4th of October 2017.
Well, that was in the UK. In the procedural, so one child who in fact was not the subject of an appeal was admitted in May 2017, and the others were all admitted in June, July 2017. That's page 2 of the procedural chronology. In AM, I'm not sure that they set out the dates. Yes, the dates are not set out in the summary of the facts on each case in AM and others, but they are in the procedural chronology.
I think the only point I'm seeking to make is under 66.
Yes.
The point that's emphasised there isn't the order which you highlight for admission. That's one point. And the other point I'm seeking to make is that all these points that are referred to at the end of 66 do apply here. The UT epistle can no consider is the fact that France bore primary responsibility for processing the claims in the context of an application of Dublin III. That applies here. France itself was bound to ensure that no breach of Article 8 of the ECHR occurred. That applies here. And that the children's representative not made recourse to the French authorities or courts. That applies here.
Yes.
What I'm pointing out is that the matters that they rely upon, or Justice Singh relies upon, are applicable here.
Well, 66 is the argument of the Secretary of State.
Yes.
It's not the reasoning of the court.
That's true. He ends up by saying, I accept the argument of the Secretary of State.
Well, he does, but he then gives his reasons for that, and his reasons are, do not address that argument. And in any event, the argument there is that the upper tribunal appears to have given no consideration. That's the complaint. There isn't a conclusion as to what would have happened if they had. And of course, that complaint cannot be made of the tribunal and FTH. It did give consideration and it reached findings of fact as to what would have occurred. And dismissed that possibility.
Lord Justice Singh was obviously focusing on the facts of the cases before us then. In paragraph 88, where he deals with ZT, and he says that Article 8 will only have a role to play in very exceptional circumstances. In particular, it must be shown that the French legal system had systemic deficiencies in it. That's on the basis that Dublin III is... we've called it an inverted commas alternative remedy. I don't particularly like that. But the reason there isn't a breach of Article 8 is because the individual, the minor, can apply under Dublin III. And unless the French legal system has got systemic problems, that's fine, as far as Article 8 is concerned. But your submission is different here. It's very different on the... as it were, on the facts you rely on. You say, in this case, whatever was going on in AM, Dublin III was inadequate in Article 8 terms because the findings in the from the expedited process interview it absolutely put a torpedo through any Dublin III procedure.
Yes.
So although there's a reference there to the French legal system, you say that the problem in this case, nothing to do with the French legal system, just so happened there was a different problem in this case, and that is because of the way the expedited process was conducted, that stymied completely the effectiveness of Dublin III as a procedure for this particular individual.
And you say the tribunal made findings of fact of that effect, and should not challenge on appeal.
Yes.
If I could just push back slightly on that. Because I see you, because you were counsel in this case, then you know it intimately.
Yes.
I think you said to me that all these points were not the subject of challenge in AM. Is that right? That in AM, it was not the case that was being made there for the applicants was not that Dublin III would not have provided an adequate remedy.
Well,
Was that?
Well, what was being said on the appeal was that.
The upper tribunal.
In the upper tribunal, what was being said, because at that stage the argument was that the procedure, the whole expedited procedure, was unlawful under Dublin III, Article 8, and common law, and there was an argument. that the consequence of that should be that the children should be admitted as a result. And I need to go back. I think the remedies that were sought are in the procedural chronology, in case your lordships would like to see it, paragraph page one. And so there wasn't...
That was the mandatory order requiring admission. Now, I got that point. I'm asking a slightly different
question. Yes.
Because what's been put to you, and you've agreed with here, and you've elaborated on, is that in the present case, there were findings of fact made by the upper tribunal that that in effect there wasn't an appropriate remedy under Dublin III that would, as it were, have made the complaints about the lack of proper process under the expedited proceeding that would have produced no practical significance. That's the context. You could always apply under Dublin III. And that certainly would have been true in the present case, at least so long as he was under 18. And
yes.
I agree, there's a problem, there's a difficulty. And so what I'm trying to, I'm pushing you on,
yes.
is are you clear that there weren't similar findings in the upper tribunal in AM?
I need to go back and check whether this specific issue of prejudice going forward was dealt with. It may not have been, for the simple reason that at the time of AM and others, the Secretary of State was in serious breach of her duty of candour, and none of those emails that I was just showing your lordship earlier were before the tribunal, indicating the way in which the findings in the expedited process were going to infect the later process. So
that must be right, isn't it?
Yes.
Because the upper tribunal decision in AM was, I think, sometime in was this end of May, wasn't it?
It was
12th to 31st of May.
Yeah.
And just using your procedural chronology, but we picked this up from the Citizen UK Court of Appeal. Ms. Justice Sewell's judgment came out some 4 months later.
Yes.
On the 18th of September, and yet the Court of Appeal in Citizens UK found that he had been misled because yes. the Secretary of State had failed to disclose everything which should have been disclosed, although it was found it wasn't a deliberate breach of the duty, it was a serious breach of the duty of candour. It must therefore follow from that, a fortiori, that at the time of the AM tribunal hearing, not all the material which emerged in this case before the tribunal was before the tribunal.
Absolutely. And it emerged in this case on a moving basis. And in fact, if it hadn't been for FTH, that's the case that the court refers to in Citizens UK as being the case which triggered accidentally the disclosure which ultimately had such serious consequences for that appeal. So it wasn't before the tribunal. But there is a further factor which answers, I think, your lordship's question. In the Court of Appeal, in AM and others, the Secretary of State did not challenge any of the findings of procedural unfairness on the facts. So there was never any examination in the Court of Appeal as to what had happened on the facts of those cases. And you can see that from paragraph 86 of the judgment. I would note that Secretary of State submissions were framed, this is AM, were framed at a generic level. She has not advanced submissions against the finding that there was unfairness on the individual facts of each of these four cases. So this whole issue of particular prejudice to the particular children, was that level of detail was never gone into. It was an academic appeal. So the court was focusing on points of principle without descending to the factual detail of the individual cases. And I think that in my submission, that's clear. What's different about this case is that there has been a detailed consideration of all the facts with the full disclosure. Findings have been made about past misconduct and damages awarded. And it's not academic because of that decision on damages.
I was there, so I should know. But was that the reason why, in your view, why Article 8 point was dealt with very summarily in Lord Justice Singh's judgment. And my recollection is that Article 8 was not at the forefront of this at all. And I think you may be right, and that it was because we were dealing with general propositions and not, as you have to with human rights, look at the specifics of the individual cases. Not sure we did have evidence of prejudice in individual cases. The prejudice, including the prejudice which derived from the defects in the expedited process. I don't think we had
that. We didn't descend. There were some examples. From my recollection of it is that I used occasional examples of what had happened in individual cases to illustrate the problem with the process as a whole. But because there was no challenge to any of the findings of procedural unfairness, we didn't descend to that level of detail. And of course, because of the disclosure that had been made late and the duty of candour issues, the hearing, which was already pretty full of issues, was even fuller.
I remember that.
Than it might
looks
have been.
As though looking at 86, and this, it looks as though what was happening. The Secretary of State did not descend to, didn't challenge the allegations of unfairness on the individual facts. They didn't engage with that process, and was dealing with it on this at a very general level of what should happen.
Yes.
Dublin III, France got by responsibilities, all those matters that were dealt with in 66. So 66 sets out the Secretary of State's position on all of this.
Yes.
And that's repeated in a sense at 86, and then 87 is the answer. And so I think what you're saying, but you may have to check on this, I think what you're saying is your recollection is, therefore, one never went into the issue of the extent to which it was actually feasible to make an application under Dublin III in the circumstances.
For each of these individual children, which would have been a fact-specific exercise in any event. And what the court's concern was, and this is what is dealt with at 88 and 89...
Do we not have the upper tribunal decision?
We do. Yes. They're all in the bundle.
So we got that, so we can see what the issues were.
Yes, we can. I'm just going to have to try to dig out what was said about prejudice. So the AM.
What's clear is that in from 80, well, really from 64 and 65 and 86, they're the ones that dealt with the issue of unfairness of common law. In the judgment in AM, is that the Secretary of State was putting this on a generic basis?
Yes.
Mr. Justice Sewell had been right.
Yes.
And the Secretary said also relied upon the decision of the Division of Court, which Lord Justice Singh deals with at the end of 65
yes.
in a rather peremptory fashion. But it's quite clear that the Secretary said was not arguing that the findings of unfairness in relation to the four individuals were factually incorrect, so there was no investigation of the facts.
No.
But can we just have a quick look at while we're here?
Yes.
At the upper tribunal, so we can just whip through it quickly.
So the upper tribunal judgments in each of the cases are.
You've got that one that you said beginning on part of the first 31 page.
31.
It's tab 7.
If it were going to be considered, it would have been considered in the context of the ZT Syria argument that was run.
Yes.
And you can see that consideration at 115. And 123. And I think probably It's after 1, 2, 3 that we start to look at what happened next. And you can see there that the tribunal makes a complaint about not having any contemporaneous material about what happened next. This is one of the things that's later picked up in the Court of Appeal. I think it's there. So, there were, you can see at 128 that there had been a suggestion by the Secretary of State that any children who successfully achieved transfer admission in consequence of the review process did so only via a formal take charge request. And the acceptance thereof by the UK. That seems to be a species of the argument. We cannot avoid the following observation. The absence of documentary evidence bearing directly on this issue is startling. So there's no information. And I think that's really all there is. The factual, the features of the procedure in AM's case, which were found to be unlawful, are set out earlier on in the judgment.
1 to 8 is about it. All right, yes, what's
so next? I will, if I may, it will take too much time to try to dig it out now.
Once we've finished today, we'll see what we've got to.
Yes.
It may be that what we'll ask is simply 1-9 confirmation, 1-9.
Yes.
But we've got ourselves now the judgments now.
Yes.
In UT, so I think that's sufficient for us to look at that. Are there any more submissions you want to make?
So that's on AM. Could we just go back to it so I can just finish on 88 and 89?
Yes. This is in
Lord Justice Singh's judgment in AM. And again, there is the twin reasoning based on ZT Syria of a need to show systemic deficiencies in the French legal system, and that there was insufficient recognition to the importance of the fact that children concerned were under the jurisdiction of the French care system. Now, my Lord, I've already agreed with my Lord Justice Hickinbottom's analysis of why I say that the issue of the French legal system is nothing to do with this case, and that's what we set out in our skeleton argument. The vice we complain about, or FTH complains about, is UK misconduct, and my submission is that is a critical distinction, which means that this test just doesn't work and does not apply. And if you look back at paragraph 95, and the things that the individuals are expected to do before turning to UK courts, none of them make any sense in circumstances where the complaint you're making is about UK misconduct. Why would you have to show systemic failings in the French system in order to vindicate a claim relating to UK misconduct? It just doesn't make any sense. So that's about 88. And so what that illustrates is that the court was focused on a ZT Syria situation, in other words, admission outside an established process. And then at 89, again, in this case, the upper tribunal did consider whether FTH was under the jurisdiction of the French care system, and he wasn't, because he was an adult. And he was simply seeking to write a story.
He was an adult for part of the time. There was a period of time from December 2017, I think, to August 2018, I think that's right, when he was still a minor.
And then it's a period of 12 months when he was an adult.
Yeah.
But the point, this is, comes back to the point I was making, and it may be that it's necessary to look at RSM, because the significance of the fact that he's under the care system is only bites at the point the order is made.
Yes.
and that the order is paid when he's an adult. So that was the thing that they were worried about, the court was concerned about. And the court in RSM, it's important to note, because I think it's actually remarked upon in the judgment. One of the judges was Lord Justice Peter Jackson, who is a family court judge. And you know, there was a concern expressed about interfering with processes that might be ongoing in relation to taking care of unaccompanied children when the child was in the care of the French system. And that was the thing that the court was concerned about. They weren't concerned about a historic position of being under the care system. The issue was, could you make an order bringing a child, saying the UK must transfer a child to the UK with forthwith or whatever, without checking with the French authorities whether that would cause a problem with their care system. That was the problem. And so in this case, that problem does not arise. And in any case, the tribunal did consider it. And before leaving AM, I just remarked that at 96, the court addresses what the sorts of orders that are appropriate in cases like this. And it makes clear that this is in the discussion of whether the mandatory order was appropriate.
So when you said before, if I understand, when you said before we're looking at the date of the order as to whether or not there were deficiencies in the French system, so which order are you referring to?
The court's order. The upper tribunal's order that the child should be transferred or admitted.
So they had made orders in all four cases of all four children. The Secretary of State transfer them or arrange for their transfer forthwith to the United Kingdom.
Yes.
And the point was they were all still minors, and that could have interfered with whatever arrangements had been made by the French care system as to what was in their best interests.
Yes, that was the point. And by the very in my submission, by the very fact that that point is remarked upon at the stage of this ZT Syria analysis, you see that what the court was concerned with was an order to admit outside ordinary processes, not any declaration as to past breaches of Article 8 or a declaration as to damages, which would, of course, not affect the French authorities' obligations at all. And I was just drawing attention to 96, the sorts of orders that the court said were appropriate in cases like this. They're a breach of the requirements of procedural fairness, and at most, the Secretary of State had to reconsider the decisions after a fair procedure. Now, in fact, in this case, we only got to the declaration. But there's nothing wrong with the type of order that the tribunal made here. So that's AM. And I should just say that in relation to CU, Citizens UK, I do say that the passage 103, where Lord Justice Singh says, in the light of the conclusion to which I've come in relation to the common law, this is at tab 8, it's unnecessary to lengthen this judgment further by addressing the procedural requirements that might arise under Article 8 of the ECHR, that is significant. Because if, as my learned friend submits, the statement in AM that Article 8 has no applicability in these cases was a broad statement outside the facts of those four cases intended to apply to any child who'd gone through this process, Lord Justice Singh could not have said what he said at 103. 103 leaves open the question of how procedural requirements operate in the expedited process.
Well, the trouble with that argument is that last sentence there, isn't it?
Yes.
In view of the considerable difficulties which lie in the way of an argument based on Article 8 in the light of the decision in ZT, which seems to suggest that he thought that. I mean, true it is he didn't think he could rule it out completely. But he does seem to have thought the same constraints
yes.
as he found in AM would apply in any other case.
Well, it may be that he anticipated that the types of relief that were being sought.
Well, yes.
We were, but
as
on the
basis, in one sense, he has left the point open.
Yes, I understand. Well, I understand that that he raises the possibility. There is an issue, but in my submission, we are now addressing that issue in detail in this case. The arguments that I've made in my respectful submission demonstrate why it could not be the case that there is some broad exclusion based on ZT Syria of the requirements of procedural fairness or the ability of children to acquire redress for it. The same point is made for your note at 173. Not necessary or helpful to explore the issue of fairness that might have arisen under Article 8 of the ECHR. So, my Lord, that leads me to my final heading, which is the Secretary of State's appeal. And I have dealt with this in detail in the skeleton argument at paragraphs 54 and following. And so, looking at the time, shall I just summarise what my submissions on that? Having gone through all of that background on the facts, on the judgments and the case law, it's my respectful submission the Secretary of State is simply wrong to maintain that ZT Syria test applies to the issue of whether the Secretary of State's decision-making in this process is procedurally fair, and is wrong to rely on the Court of Appeals judgment in AM. Neither of those judgments can justify this court absolving the Secretary of State of the requirement that's imposed on her by Section 6 of the Human Rights Act to comply with the ECHR in decision-making, or of depriving him of his Section 7 right to bring proceedings against the Secretary of State when she acts unlawfully, or eliminate the Section 8 Human Rights Act right to a remedy, to request a remedy. The whole rationale for ZT Syria, as I've already submitted, is that there were processes and procedures in Dublin III for achieving entry, and they should not be circumvented. That rationale simply does not apply here. Now, my Lord, I don't want to take up any further time repeating submissions that effectively I've been making throughout the course of my analysis of the background, but they're obviously drawn together in the skeleton argument. If it would assist your Lordships for me to spend more time in them in the morning, I'm not sure what course you want to take now.
We'll see how far we get this evening. I think in the course of this afternoon, the building blocks of your arguments, as far as I'm concerned, have become really quite clear. And I don't think repetition of them actually would really take matters much further. I think, as I said, you've been faced with distinguishing Syria and AM. You've got the point about the findings of fact in this case, which are critical. So I think you've got all of that, and you've got a structure for it around the infringement as opposed to the engagement of Article 8.
Essentially on the... I suppose the point I really want to draw back to is that there was obviously a breach of Article 8 procedural rights in this process.
Yes.
And perhaps that I should highlight,
yes,
having looked at that case law. There's no equivalency. It's no question of inappropriately drawing an equivalence between common law procedural rights and Article 8 procedural rights. The tribunal correctly identified the principles set out in W and McMichael, and I've shown your Lordships the case law which demonstrates that it's not just about substantive reunification or separations. It's about the right to a fair procedure in reaching those decisions, irrespective of the outcome of those decisions. And that, when you look at what happened in this process, it plainly could never be said that the FTH had a fair opportunity to engage in that process. He plainly did not. And so he is entitled to a remedy following that case law. And there is nothing in either ZT Syria or AM, despite it's the initial impression that is given, which bites on that right because of the very different factual circumstances between FTH and ZT Syria, but also because AM was considering a very narrow objection to an order to admit outside the expedited process. And I have drawn, and I do rely on in full on my submissions in my skeleton argument at paragraphs 54 onwards, which really draw together the arguments that I've made today based on that case law and the facts.
I think what we will carry on, if that's all right, Mr. Kelly, and see where we get to.
Okay. Thank you.
A number of points. The first point, or one of the points that my learned friend made, was that there's no question that if the expedited process had been a Dublin III process, and a learned friend mentioned that there had been some confusion about that, some flick-flacking in the relevant case law, that he would have had a valid Article 8 claim. That was one of the points a learned friend made. That is not correct for this reason, that even assuming, which is not the case, that the that the expedited process had been Dublin III compliant, engagement at that stage of the process does not mean that the ZT threshold does not apply, for which proposition, see RSM, where it was made clear by the court that just because an applicant has begun the process of engaging with the asylum process, that does engage with the expedited process, he still had at all material times the opportunity to make use of the formal Dublin procedures, which use was not issue in that case, was whether a claimant could challenge a decision not to accept a take charge request under Article 17, I think it was, by the UK authorities. Well, we don't quibble with that.
My recollection is that all that I was dealing with there was, I mean, it was all obiter because it was outside the grounds of appeal.
But it's all obiter, but in any event, plainly distinguishable. That was a claimant who had done the opposite of this claimant and engaged with the Dublin III process, resulting in a take charge request being made, resulting in it being refused, and was simply trying to challenge that in these courts. It's not a principle which takes the issue before this court any further. Next, my learned friend relied upon the fact that there came a point after the initial, I think, four-month period, give or take, where the claimant was no longer a minor, at which point his entitlement changed from an entitlement under Article 8 of the Dublin Regulation to an entitlement, if he had one, under Article 17. And we simply say, well, that's neither here nor there for the purpose of the ZT principle, if it applies. Insofar as it applies, it required the claimant to make use of whatever means were available under the Dublin regulation to achieve family reunion. Whilst he was a child, he could make use of 8.1, whilst an adult, 17. But either way, there was a scheme which was overarching and which we say was sufficient to discharge Article 8. My learned friend refers to findings at permission stage relating to the issue of alternative remedy and some of the findings that were made by the court on that issue. Lest it cause confusion, it's really important to note that there were two parallel but different arguments going on below. One was the contention by the Secretary of State that for the purpose of the principles of judicial review, because the claimant had access to an alternative remedy, one couldn't claim JR. It's the traditional, conventional, common law principle. The other, which is an entirely separate issue, an entirely separate principle, is the ZT principles and making use of Article 8 or 17 for that purpose and the failure of the claimant to do so. Whatever findings were made, we don't appeal, for what it's worth, the findings in relation to alternative remedy, those are there. But whatever findings were made in relation to that are of no application whatever to whatever findings the tribunal did or didn't make on in relation to ZT. It's an irrelevance, we would respectfully submit. Can I next deal with this point, which I'll call the infection point? That is the point that in this case there was a finding that if this claimant had applied under Article 8 or Article 17, it is likely, said the tribunal, that the findings within the expedited process would have been held against him. And my learned friend makes the point, well, that's the factual point, which takes us entirely outside the ZT matrix or is a reason for holding that ZT doesn't apply. The problem with that argument is as follows, that it's right, of course, that ZT makes the point that that every case is entirely fact-sensitive. Your Lordships will recall the passages, and it talks about the Syrian baby case being an example of a fact-sensitive case. But it was fact-sensitive in this particular sense, that the facts went to the issue of whether the exceptional threshold criteria was met or not. That's why the Syrian baby case was such an exceptional factual scenario. The urgency was so great on those assumed facts that the exceptional threshold was met. The difficulty is they're using exceptional circumstances. That was not at no point in my learned friend's oral submissions or the written submissions was that contended on the claimant's behalf. The other arguments were made about his psychiatric vulnerability, but this infection point was not relied upon, nor was there any finding at all by the tribunal that this infection point was capable in principle of meeting the exceptional circumstances threshold. And whilst it is true, and I accept, that the tribunal did make a finding that had the claimant availed himself of the Dublin regulation, it is likely that the finding would have been that he was not entitled. It did not make a finding that that was an inevitability. Particular finding must be put in its proper context. If one picks up the core bundle, please, and goes to tab 8, page 78. And just to draw attention to other passages in the judgment. So at paragraph 6, on page 80, last sentence in paragraph 6, on the 8th of March 2017, the UK informed the French authorities that a take charge request could be progressed if contact details for FH were located. It does not appear.
Page 80, which paragraph?
Paragraph 6, last sentence. So on the 8th of March 2017, UK authorities informed the French authorities that a take charge request could be progressed if contact details were located. It does not appear the French authorities took any further action. And then at paragraph 34, please, of the same judgment, the respondent's role, so paragraph 34, page 90, the respondent's role was to review any available evidence and then indicate to the French authorities whether, if they made a take charge request under Dublin III, it was likely that the request would be accepted. When the UK authorities responded to the French authorities, they colour-coded the lists, with green indicating that a take charge request was likely to be successful. His final response was sent on the 8th of March. And in this case, the evidence was that the claimant's case was one of the green marked bits on the list. And then finally, paragraph 101, please, which So, paragraph 107. However, Julia Farman's witness statement, dated the 20th of April, said that the UK authorities coded the applicant's case green in its 8th of March 2017 response to indicate that there was potential for a future charge request, provided contact details could be provided for FH. And then the final passage I want to take you to...
Where is that on page
107? Page 101, top of page 107.
It's
paragraph 101, page 107. Top very... however, Julia Farman's. And then, if your lordship picks up... what you then go also... Sorry, go back in the bundle to... Sorry, bear with me for a moment... So paragraph 73 on page 99. So this is within the criticisms of the decision-making process. Furthermore, we note that as the decision-making actually took place in London, the respondent would have had easy access to his own records when deciding on a claimed family relationship and could have called up these files either before FTH or YH was interviewed. In the current case, the respondent had issued YH with a resident permit as a refugee, as recently as the 21st of November. Therefore, its file should have been readily to hand and would have shown that FH had provided the same names as the applicant for their mother, sister, brother, and also given the same town of origin, and stated that he also spoke Saho as a first language. So that is the background against which any take charge request would have been assessed. So, of course, we accept that there was this finding of likelihood, but taking in the context of the other findings made, it falls well short of inevitability. Even assuming that it could be said to be true that the Secretary of State would have refused a formal take charge request, that still would not be, in our submission, sufficient to discharge the ZT test. That would not have amounted to a systemic deficiency in the French system, which is, of course, the test. More to the point, even if a take charge request had then been refused by the UK authorities, the claimant's recourse within Dublin would then have been to challenge the refusal of the UK authorities to accept the take charge request. The Dublin regulation, which we say is compliant with Article 8, specifically envisages exactly such a process. If your lordship then goes to the authorities bundle and goes to the Dublin regulation, Article 27, at the very back of the bundle.
Bundle authorities.
It's the 22 and Article 27, I think, is the relevant one.
All of these points are proceeding, as I understand, on the basis that it's the exceptionality test in ZT that applies.
Yes.
All proceeding on that basis.
It does proceed on that basis. But the important point is, in interchange with my learned friend, one of the points that my Lord Justice Hickinbottom properly made is that, of course, every case is fact sensitive. But that issue of fact sensitivity goes to the issue of whether there are exceptional circumstances or not. That's the only issue to which it really goes. I appreciate that, but it is premised on, I accept, my lord's point that ZT is in principle of some relevance.
Yes.
On which point, for what it's worth, of course we accept that there are material distinctions between every different case. But the key point in this case, the reason, if nothing else, that it is engaged, is because it's certainly a case when lawyers got involved that they were seeking to say we want access to the UK without having to make any application for asylum, which is precisely what was said in pre-action correspondence in the ZT case, if nothing else. So the suggestion that one can simply, as it were, shut out of the window as if it didn't exist, ZT, and all of those principles, we say, can't possibly be right. But I was on, just resuming, before we quite properly interrupted me with an entirely appropriate intervention. We
have to say that.
But we do say that there is, if you go to Article 27, so it's number one, paragraph one. So remedies, the applicant or another person is referred to in Article 1 C or D shall have the right to an effective remedy in the form of an appeal or a review, in fact, and in law against a transfer decision before a court or tribunal. Well, that's the article that the case of MS is about at tab 10 and the case of MA is about at tab 11. So if a charge request had been refused, the claimant's remedy would then have been to challenge that in this court, entirely within the scope of the Dublin regulation. There's no requirement or obligation or necessity for him to deploy Article 8 entirely outside of that framework. And the final point on this infection point is to note this, that the risk of cross-infection of this, in other words, of the unfair decisions in the expedited process infecting subsequent applications under Dublin is, of course, specifically referred to at paragraph 96 to 98 of CUK. So the court was
it's
96-98. So the court was entirely mindful of that issue and that problem. But when it came to MA, it plainly didn't consider that that was a sufficient basis for systemic unfairness for the purposes of the for the purpose of Dublin regulation not being applicable. So that's my answer to those to the infection point. The final point is this. I think my learned friend's submissions at one stage seemed to say, well, if nothing else, what the claimant was entitled to was a declaration that the procedure followed was not itself compliant with the procedural incidence of Article 8, and that at a minimum is what was claimant was entitled to. A number of points, and in reliance upon that, my little friend then drew attention to the various paragraphs in the European case law which supported that proposition. The first problem with that submission is that it's very similar to the submission which was dealt with in ZT. And in ZT, there's the observation, I think it may be paragraph 64, just remind myself of the exact paragraph, the Lordship's note.
So looking at 96 to 8, I'm sorry, slightly early, in fact, looking at 96 to 98 in Citizens UK,
yes.
I'm not sure that they actually support the proposition you put forward. Your proposition was that the issue of cross-infection was specifically referred to in 96 to 98. In fact, if looking at that, the nearest thing you get to it is in paragraph 98, which is there were at least in principle children who gave up and never made a formal application precisely because they'd been given an adverse decision as a result of the expedited process. That's not the same as the finding of the Secretary of State's policy that he or she would take that into account when deciding upon a formal application.
Yeah, it may be that stay with me for a moment.
It's not a finding. Because it was a generic case. There's no finding that any specific applicant's case, the approach to any specific applicant would have been infected by.
No, I accept
the,
that.
The procedural unfairness in process.
I entirely accept that, my lord. It's an entirely proper point.
So are you going to show us 64?
You can answer it if you want, but I mean, that was the point I was just saying. I don't think it really...
They do deal with the point generically. I think it's first, the reality is the Secretary of State's officials did take into account what had happened at the expedited process later, it's 96. That's the infection point that Leonard Friend's talking about, as I understand it. It was dealt with generically, but my point is, I mean, it's not my main point, but one of my points is that the Court of Appeal in AM were plainly must have had that in mind, were aware of that issue, but didn't... see fit to comment that that might be a reason in and of itself why the exceptional circumstances test may be made out, or why ZT might not apply. I was going to just remind
the... Sorry, bear with me for a moment.
You said it was 64, I think you're right, 64 and ZT.
It's 64 and ZT, exactly. Where they deal it's the point about, my learned friend relies on all the European authorities, and paragraph 64 of ZT makes the point that those cases don't involve the relationship between the Dublin process and the procedures of Article 8, so that they're all dealt with and distinguished on that basis. But dealing with the point more specifically, this point that, well, effectively what they could have done is declare that there was procedural unfairness, that was not the declaration sought, and that was not the declaration granted. The declaration sought at the pre-action process, the declaration sought in the claimant's grounds, was of a continuing breach of Article 8 in the sense of a continuing failure to admit the claimant. That was what was sought. That, however one reads the declaration, is what was granted. The declaration was not limited on any sensible reading to a narrow declaration that there was a breach of the procedural incidents of Article 8. The next point is that this issue. Say again. This is my last issue. I'm just dealing with points in relation to this issue. But we say that the issue was in essence disposed of in any event by the Court of Appeal in AM, because you'll recall that the Court accepted the submission that Article 8 did not require approach either to decision-making or to admission outside Dublin III. And when the Court accepts the submission that a different approach to decision-making is not required, it must, we say, be talking about requiring a common law compliant process. It doesn't require the Secretary to have done anything differently to that which they actually did under the expedited process. So we say the point has been determined on any sensible reading of the submissions.
I haven't really followed this point. Could you
Perhaps if we just go to AM, just to draw attention to the language which is used in the submission.
It's paragraph 66.
That's right. So at paragraph 66, it's both paragraph 66 and paragraph 53.5, but paragraph 66 says, ground 5 relates to Article 8 of the ECHR. It is submitted on behalf of the Secretary of State that Article 8 did not require either, and I emphasise that, a different approach to the expedited process, or for the admission of these four children to the UK outside the framework of the expedited process, or the Dublin III regulation. So there are two points being made in the submission, both that Article 8 does not require a different approach to that was in fact taken under the process procedurally, and it was submitted that it doesn't require admission, and both of those submissions were accepted. So we say that submission that is made by my learned friend has been disposed of. And we would respectfully submit, insofar as it's necessary to do so, that the Court of Appeal in AM was plainly right to dispose of the matter in this way. And that is for this reason, in essence, that it's not appropriate, and this is really the error in my learned friend's submission, to look at Article 8 through a bare but-for causation analysis. In other words, to submit that, but for the breach of this procedure, claimant would have been admitted to the UK and therefore breach of Article 8. But that is not the appropriate analysis, because the analysis under Article 8 is much broader than that. On the facts, what actually happened is, because of the failure to be granted a remedy under the expedited process, the claimant was then thrown back onto their normal, ordinary, conventional Dublin regulation process. That was the consequence of the refusal. And looking at things broadly, as one must, and holistically, striking a fair balance between competing interests of the individual and the community as a whole, varying the duty according to the particular circumstances, having regard to the margin of appreciation, the consequence that claimants were in fact thrown back onto their ordinary Dublin remedies, was not something that gave rise to a breach of Article 8. The residual right to rely upon the Dublin regulations was not an answer to common law fairness, the common law fairness point. That's what this court found in CUK. But that does not mean, it does not follow from that, that it might not be an answer to the Article 8 point. And effectively, we say that is the answer to the Article 8 point. Putting the matter a different way, finding that Article 8 did require a fundamentally different approach to the decision-making process risks undermining the Dublin regulation process itself as the primary process for making decisions in this sort of case.
It's very important I understand what you're saying.
Yes.
And I'm not following this argument, so I really need to understand it.
Yes.
You're talking about a different sort of procedure, but the argument that's put is that there are requirements of procedural fairness.
Yes.
Under Article 8,
yes.
And we were shown a couple of cases in relation to that,
yes. Mm-hmm.
And those cases show that there should be a remedy for that.
Yes.
That seems clear enough. I don't understand the point that you're now making in relation to that issue.
And the answer to the issue is that the cases on which my learned friend relies do not engage ZT paragraph 64 with the balance that has to be struck between the Dublin process and Article 8 rights of the individual. That is the point of distinction. And when one looks at, under Article 8, what is required is a more holistic, open-textured approach, striking a balance between competing interests, looking at the particular circumstances, looking at the decision-making process as a whole. And when one does that and appreciates that there was always this regulation in the background.
That goes back to your fundamental problem.
It goes
right
back to
the
fundamental
beginning,
point.
Which
yes.
is that when you're looking at what whether or not there's been an infringement, what a remedy here, whether or not there's been an infringement of Article 8, this is in the context
yes.
of the rights that are available under Article 8.
Precisely. Precisely. And we say that the decision-making process in the Dublin regulation, which was always available itself, is what strikes that fair balance between it for the purposes of Article 8.
Yes. All right.
Although it is fair to say that if you look at 65 of ZT series, that Justice Beetson, what he's saying there is the issue is the relative weight of the two regimes. In the sense of the human rights case needed to override the processes and procedures of the Dublin system. And then he poses the question, in what circumstances will Article 8 impose a positive duty to admit an individual who has not used the Dublin
yes.
processes and procedures?
Yes.
So it is somebody who's trying to enter the country
yes.
outside that process.
Yes.
And therefore it is held only in very acceptable circumstances.
Yes.
Can you bypass Dublin? So the specific analysis in ZT is limited in that way. And I think that there's considerable force in Ms. Kilroy's submissions about ZT, speaking for myself, but I think her real problem is AAF.
Well, yes. Well, it is. And that's that if it weren't for AAM, I can well see that that the terrain may look different. But effectively, this point has now been disposed of in test cases, which were for all intents and purposes.
And although the full picture of procedural unfairness had not emerged in AAM, that is true.
No.
At the stage of the upper tribunal judgment, so there weren't findings of fact.
No.
By the time of the Court of Appeal hearing, the full
yes.
horror of what had gone on had emerged pretty clearly, hadn't it?
Yes.
For Citizens UK.
Yes.
And yet that doesn't seem to have led the Court of Appeal to reach a different conclusion.
Yes. They could have said, having made those very strong findings under the common law, well, that it seems to us, gives the claimant a huge leg up in any case where they're seeking to show exceptional circumstances. That was, didn't they, for just
push hard, but it's very important for both your clients that you feel you've had a fair crack at the whip.
Let me just turn my back for a moment, if I may. My lords, though, and for what it's worth, I'm happy to record on the record that I feel that I've had that fair crack.
And we will certainly take up all the points on the skeleton argument in the light of your submissions. Well, we're very grateful to both counsel. We will consider our judgments in this matter in the usual way. Please agree a form of order that we receive the drafts for corrections for grammatical and textual grounds only. We only wish to hear from you further in writing not literally, unless we say so.